Right, we'll open it up to the floor for questions or points of view. Anybody? Anything to say?
I've got a couple of things, Chris.
Excuse
me, everyone, I'm losing my voice a wee bit. To both, actually, if I can start with Elgin, I think your phrase about there's a really strong business case for all the different parts of the world for the different Irish communities to work together. I do agree with that very strongly. What I would flag up is that I think the key with that is to avoid some of the old-fashioned ways where the Irish community would have focused on the kind of almost back of a biscuit tin Irishness, because I think those Irish communities now have a tremendous opportunity, if they work together from a business perspective, to actually have some really quite powerful influence. And certainly I think the more recent diaspora that has come over the last 5 years is very much professional Irish people who have come over certainly to Britain, and they're accountants and they're this and they're that. And I think the business opportunities that presents, I think, are absolutely huge. I'll be watching that very, very closely with the Post. I've been very supportive of your dementia campaign, you may or may not know. As a Lib Dem, part of the coalition, I've worked closely with the Minister of Health around dementia. We've managed to get some wins, certainly for people in Northern Ireland, which obviously make it that much easier, a bit harder because of Ireland being a different country, clearly. But that was good, and I applaud the Irish Post on that. I was speaking to someone only a couple of months or so ago, who knew far more about the whole Irish Post history than I did, almost as much as yourself, Neil. And she was saying that she genuinely felt recently it had turned a corner and was really getting back into the Irish community. So I'm just quoting that verbatim, so, you know, hats off to that. Neil, I thought your speech was absolutely brilliant. Diaspora every 30 years, that's quite right. Couple of things. Talking about unemployment is low in the south because people emigrate. I think what you're saying there is absolutely true, but for me the really important thing there, and I'm having more and more meetings with the ambassador, with the Irish, what have you, with my front bench Lib Dem Northern Ireland hat on. And Southern Ireland has done, or Ireland has done, extremely well to get through the last few years, but actually that unemployment rate isn't a true rate, in the sense if those 300,000 people hadn't emigrated. And your phrase, it's a very dislocating experience. I'm half Irish, my mother's Irish, my aunt came over to this country many years ago to teach, spinster, you know, that sort of thing. And it was a shockingly difficult thing to do, particularly for people who are forced as opposed to people who chose. I think that's a very important phrase. On the American politics, I listen with great interest about raising $2 million for Hillary Clinton. So clearly I'm going to take your card and we're going to have a long discussion. But what's really important, what you say, and I'm a Lib Dem. Okay, I'm half Irish. I'm passionately proud of being Irish. I'm actually proud being the shadow or the Lib Dem Northern Ireland spokesman. But we're the smaller party, you know, all these sort of things. But we're in coalition government. And one of the things that strikes me, one of the reasons why I got involved and agreed to be patron of a newish group 2 years ago, you know, Irish Liberal Democrats were starting from small acorns, is that I think generally across all the parties, the influence that the Irish can play in British politics, I think should grow, is the absolute truth of it. I really do. Now, there are lots of reasons I won't go into today. There are people with much more experience than me in the room as to why it's never had the same clout, the influence that you clearly got it in America. And I've known that you've had in America. Tip Moynihan, what a speaker, you know. But I was very determined when I got elected, and trust me, there aren't a busted lot of Irish votes in Eastbourne, so I'm actually doing this because I care about it, is that it occurred to me that the very considerable Irish vote in, or Irish people in this country who can vote, actually I think their influence and power could be quadrupled. Don't entirely know how, and you know, all the political, I'll tell you one way how.
and which you've sorted over in Ireland with certainly the Democrats, you're willing to look at the Republicans, the more the politicians know that a particular vote feels a certain way, be it the Grey vote, be it the BME vote, women vote, what have you, trust me, the more the politicians listen. And the Irish vote generally in the UK, quite rightly, because Labour earned it and worked at it, has very, very much been seen as, well, this is Labour vote, and Labour earned that. So to ways about it, what I would say, not just to be irritating to Chris, but to put the power back to that number of tens or hundreds of thousands of Irish people in the UK, is that if we ever get to a point in Britain where the Irish vote has the same organisation that you and your colleagues have developed in America, believe you me, all the political parties and all the governments in this country will listen to you very closely, because there's 3 million. And that's something, probably much the irritation of Chris and others, I'm really interested in. So thank you very much for your talk. I thought it was absolutely fascinating. And you have to give me your card before you get your brother. Thank you.
That's your calling card, not your bank card. Right, I think Ivan wants to say a few words.
I don't want to be churlish, but I think probably raising $2 million for Hillary Clinton is slightly easier than raising it for the Liberal Democrats.
It's a better, it's a better product.
Was it $2 million or $20 million? $2 million. I mean, just on the point about the so-called Irish vote, I mean, I think that what you said is okay, but on the other hand, I don't think you ever take people for granted, nor do you ever generalise about people. And I think there is a strong body of support in the Irish community for the Labour Party, which we're very proud of. But it's important that we don't take those people for granted, nor do we ever, as I say, make sweeping generalisations that all Irish people must be Labour voters. Two points, really. Fascinating presentations. I'd love to talk to you a little bit more about your personal story, which is a remarkable story in many ways. Two points, really. One is, I'm new to this job, so I've been in this role for nearly 3 weeks. And I always say, after 3 weeks, don't pretend you're an expert, because people find you out very, very quickly. But early observations which are relevant to the presentations that you've made. One would be that despite for 15 years there's been a much better political process in Northern Ireland, there is a level of peace and stability that people could never have dreamt of. If you scratch the surface, sadly, you don't go from war to love. But after 15 years, you might hope you'd gone from war to mutual respect, friendships, trust. And under the political accommodation that's been reached, the settlement, there isn't very much evidence of that. Now, the diaspora's potential to help with those relationships, that mutual respect, those friendships, those networks, of people coming together from different denominations, different backgrounds, I don't know whether there is a sense that the diaspora has a potential role to play, because it worries me that it's still such a cool piece, such a cold piece. And as I say, I'm not unrealistic, you don't go from war to love overnight. The second point is the concern I have, which is often, I don't think, spoken about often enough in Northern Ireland. Obviously, everybody quite rightly, particularly in terms of the horrendous events, by the way, of the last few days of letter bombs and all the rest of it, people don't talk enough about the economic and social challenges. They talk about security, security, security. Yet, if you look at the what I would describe as a cycle in too many of Northern Ireland's communities of poor educational achievement, worklessness, and intergenerational deprivation, that is the breeding ground, frankly, for the extremists. Because when people feel so disconnected, lacking in opportunities, lacking in aspiration, and they don't see what's in it for them, this peace process, i.e. the peace dividend, where is it? Obviously, there's always that fear that those people will then be exploited by extremists. So the question is, in terms of inward investment, economic investment from a global diaspora perspective, what the potential would be in terms of people of Irish descent who go and live elsewhere, then make it, do well, succeed, achieve, in whatever sectors of the economy, of them looking, I mean, obviously I'm interested in a Northern Ireland context specifically, looking to go back, create jobs, develop businesses, and all the rest of it. because we know that there's a disproportionate public sector versus private sector in Northern Ireland. Yet we know also, I think, 90% of businesses, 95% of businesses are small and medium-sized enterprises. So what is the potential power of your global diaspora network that I know you're, it's really exciting the way that you've articulated that, to identify those type of business people who would then be willing to come back and invest and look at business opportunities?
In particular, I spent some time with Máirtín Ó-Muilleoir, the current Lord Mayor of Belfast, who actually has a publication in America as well called The Irish Echo. And I did see firsthand, I had about three visits to Belfast, and I actually met him in New York a couple of times. And Máirtín was doing some good work all the way. He'd organized conferences out in New York. I know he had a new Belfast, New York conference, and he was certainly, that was his prime motivation. I think on the big level of where you find the donors or big business people, Niall might speak a bit more about that. From my own point of view, I think you have to have a connected up diaspora. You have to have people that believe that they're doing it for the right business reasons, but also because they are helping their homeland. I do feel that there's so much more work to be done on identifying the people out there that make up this diaspora, and particularly, you know, you're talking about the business strand of it. Other than myself or the Irish Post, Irish America, we're not a bottomless place. We're a commercial organisation like anyone. But there needs to be some funding that, I know, I think Niall does it more than me, but there needs to be, you know, research. You know, if I decide to put some energy into it, I could have maybe two full-time interns here working in the Irish Post, constantly studying the Irish business community, identifying who's the next people coming up, all of that sort of thing. Again, there's only so much we can do at any one moment in time. I sometimes feel there's so much to be done. But again, it needs, my view is it needs Irish government input. And I think it's money very well spent. I made the point earlier, you know, you can easily identify the beacons or the great men who came here in the 50s, 60s, builders that work their way up now, employ companies of thousands of people, you know. You can list them off. There's 30 or 40 of them, names, you know, household names. For me, of my own age, you know, do I see a huge peer group around me that's identified? I don't, you know. I haven't been introduced, or I'll have to go and find them myself. I think, Niall, you've a bit more of experience this than me.
Yeah, it's an interesting idea. I mean, the problem that Northern Ireland has is perception. In America, there was a perception, you're absolutely right, it's a cold piece. But not only that, during the summer when these riots happened, this is what the businessmen are looking at. And they are absolutely flat out saying to us, we're not interested. And that's not the correct political thing to say, but it's the reality on any kind of...
It's important to know.
It's important to know, because I don't think the people in Northern Ireland... I mean, yeah. We hosted Peter Robinson and Martin McGuinness at a dinner recently. And, you know, trying to get them... I mean, they're in a room, but they're already handicapped by the fact that everyone in that room is carrying this sort of prejudice of that headline or that media story about particularly these riots. You say to Peter Robinson, you know, this has to stop. This, if you really want to seriously set up economic investment from the United States, the first thing any guy is going to say is it safe for my people? And that doesn't necessarily mean he does a lot of research. He probably calls up AP and Googles it and says, oh my God, you know. So that's unfortunately still the case. And it's almost impossible, we find, to get around that reality. As regards, you know, the long-term future for Northern Ireland, I almost in a contradictory sense, I did always think it would take at least another generation of leadership, because you've gone from a very traumatic period in a society to one where the memories are still very fresh. I think it's going to take another generation of leadership to actually bring about that properly.
Thanks very much.
Excuse me. Yeah. See you later on. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks, Evan. Can I just say a name check here? We're very fortunate to have Senator Mark Daly, who's the spokesman on Irish overseas in the diaspora. So it's... We cannot have a meeting on that without having an input from yourself.
I have about 70 million constituents. So I have more constituents than everybody else inside in the Irish Parliament. And I'm interested on what Elgin had to say in relation to we need somebody in Dublin as a resource. And I've produced a policy paper on the Irish Overseas and the Diaspora, which basically was about the first issue has to be we need a minister for the Irish Overseas and the Diaspora. And most recently, the Minister for Foreign Affairs, Eamon Gilmore, said that we should have that. Now, I don't see that happening in this particular term of this government, but what I would be hoping for is that Labour would bring forward its policy paper and would say the same thing. Sinn Féin would do the same, and Fine Gael, so that when all parties go in for their discussions on the formation of the next government, that the Irish Post and Irish Central would put pressure on them and say, well, you did make this commitment and we would like you to honour that commitment. I know I speak here in a parliament where all commitments are honoured, just like at home, so we needn't worry about what they promise at election times not being fulfilled. But I think one of the big issues, and I was at the Constitutional Convention, is a very simple issue of giving a vote to the Irish Overseas and the Diaspora. And this nearly sounds revolutionary in Ireland because it was touch and go what way it would pan out at the Constitutional Convention, whether or not they would decide to extend it. And when you look at the research, extending a vote at the presidential election in Ireland is the lowest form of expression that we could give to our diaspora, because other countries, there are only 9 other countries extend a vote at presidential elections, but all those are executive presidential elections, so they have substantial power. No other country would be extending a vote to its diaspora merely at what is largely, with obviously huge constitutional safeguards for the president and what he can do in terms of referring bills to the Supreme Court, but largely ceremonial presidency. And what I think is very important when you're talking about this global media, the pressure that should be exerted by yourselves and the Irish in relation to extend the voting rights to the Irish overseas. Now, how you would do that is obviously a matter of debate. The Shannon is probably the most obvious way to do it, because no Irish government is ever going to allow a couple of million, nearly 3.2 million people decide who's going to form the next government. And the cry that went out at the Constitutional Convention is no representation without taxation, and I'm sure none of you here want to be taxed by the Irish government. So I think there are some of the issues to be looked at. And the other issue is in relation to what that minister would do in terms of education, and doing what your two interns would be doing, is doing what I suppose the most successful diaspora in the world are the Israeli lobby. You see it on Capitol Hill, and Neil O'Dowd has seen it on Capitol Hill to great effect. They know the top 100 in every city who is connected to Israel. They have them all down, everybody. And they have no fear of asking them for money. So I think we need to expect more of the Irish at home in terms of expanding the voting rights, not just at presidential election, but there should be a number of seats specifically in the Senate for the Irish Overseas and the Diaspora and those in the North, so that when you have a problem, you know, it's very hard to get through to the President, believe it or not, when you have a problem. So at the moment in time, the only proposal on the table is that you would get a vote for the President, but he's not the person you ring when you have a problem, that you say, well, we need you to get on board on this particular topic, whether it's, you know, the issues of the Irish and mental health issues affected by the immigrants and all those other issues. But that's a campaign, it really is. But the first part of that campaign is getting every political party in Ireland to say, yes, we'll appoint that minister. And from there, you have somebody that you can harass and harangue and cajole and, you know, encouraged to do what needs to be done, instead of just two interns done by the Irish Post, which, you know, any other country in the world would do it automatically. It's a huge resource, and yet we don't actually channel it and give it an expression at all. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much for being here.
I'm aware of it. Thank you. I'm aware what a poor chair I've been. I've only let politicians speak so far, so I'm going to open it up to the floor. But before I do, keeping on the political theme, I'd also like to thank Sir Peter Bottomley. Who's an excellent friend of Ireland. He turns up at many of our events. He leads many of he's led the community events in London. So thanks, Sir Peter, for turning up. Anybody? Marion?
Could people say their names and who they are?
I'm Marion Elliott, the director of the Institute of Irish Studies at Liverpool University, and I became part of the diaspora before many people were born here. I came over in 1971 to study, as the troubles got worse, I lived through that over here. Although I do have to say that there always was an open door, although it may have been much worse had I been a young Irish male. And very quickly at that open door, when I first came over, I was involved in setting up a number of Irish organisations, including this institute at Liverpool University. But before I go on to just talk of the changes that I've seen, for the better, but also some of the reasons why the diaspora here is not as influential as in America, I wanted to pay tribute also to Brendan McClure, who tended to actually pick up all us waifs and strays when we came over here, gave me the best book review I've ever received in the Irish Post. And I hope we're opening up the Brendan McClure Library up in Liverpool in the spring, that has a complete run in hard copy of the Irish Post that Brendan's family left to us. But I wanted to pick up in our two excellent speakers, and Niall has been involved in this for forever, as you say. It is about people, you know, people who feel very strongly Irish and gather other people like that to them, and I've seen this happen in this country. I think a lot of Irish did keep their heads down at the height of the Troubles. After all, terrible, shameful things were being done in our name. But gradually, I have seen that change quite dramatically. You are right, Elgin, in that, you know, that earlier generation, you know, that came over in the 50s and 60s, and we know their name as businessmen, there's a bit of a gap, you know, people who are middle-aged, but there's a young business community coming up now. I mean, the Irish Professional Network's only been going for a few years. We host the Northern version. And they are very proud of their Irishness, and they're full of energy. And I think that's something that could be harnessed. And I don't think, when I did first come over, I think the Irish community over here was quite divided, particularly if you came over with my accent, you weren't regarded as properly Irish. Mm-hmm. And that has been said less to me since the Good Friday Agreement than it was said back in that time. But I think we are working together my team work very closely, not just with, you know, education at every level, and the Irish Professional Network and the Irish Post, who've been great supports in the Irish Embassy, but Irish Community Care as well. I think, you know, we are coming together in a much stronger way than we were in the past. And peace in continuing peace in Northern Ireland is going to be absolutely vital to that, because that's what splintered us before. And so, yeah, I do watch what happens with great fear. But anyway,
I think.
Just
on the points there, you know, an interesting one is when I went out to see Niall in New York in March. I'll never forget getting up in the morning of this lunch. And getting dressed, and then looking at my tie, and this was standard what we'd wear here in England. And I said, I must get a green tie. So I took off down to a, I can't remember, I think it was Bergdorf's or something. Went looking and found this green tie, and it was quite, for some reason, quite luminous, you know, luminous green, you know. And I'll never forget, it's totally different being an Irish-American, you know, you really kind of get into it. I think even now when I came up to Essex House, kind of, was looking at me, where did you get the tie from?
Exactly,
but I have to say, I've even taken that that tie now into meetings here in England. We've adapted here, the Irish in Britain, you know, we've conformed much more, and rightly so, you know, in some ways. Not all, I wouldn't have said it. But I just thought it was very interesting to watch Niall spread over the table a cup of tea in the middle of...
I don't actually recall that. But I do think that, Marianne, you know, you've been a great, your books and everything have been fantastic over the years, but I think you touch on something very important, which I didn't touch on, is that the end of the Northern Troubles allowed everyone to belong. Mm-hmm. And I see this in America all the time. Irish Americans who did not want to become involved in their heritage because they immediately got caught up in this issue of, are you Catholic or Protestant or who you for, suddenly you have permission to do that. And it's a huge opportunity for both here and in America to bring in a whole group of people that there's no guilt, there's no Irish guilt for us. Like, this is a big success story. What happened with the Irish peace process, I mean, a day doesn't go by, a week doesn't go by, I don't get called from somebody saying, can you explain the American role in the Irish peace process? Because there are academics, as you know, all over the world, but also a lot of other people were looking on that as a fantastic achievement, which was like, you know, out of all, almost out of the blue when it happened. And I think that allows Elgin and me and you and everyone else to reach into people who you couldn't reach 15, 20, who would say, religious warfare or whatever, I don't want anything to do with that, or I don't want to deal with that issue. And I think that's the biggest thing, and why the continuation of peace in Northern Ireland is absolutely critical to everything we both do, mm-hmm. we all do.
Yeah. Sean?
Thanks, Chris. Sean Kennedy from the London Irish Centre. I'm chair of the London Irish Centre up in Camden Town, and as I understand it, the London Irish Centre is the biggest and the largest physical Irish centre outside of Ireland up there. And I was curious, Niall, of your thoughts on this, because there's very good connections in Ireland, in the UK, with Irish community organisations. There's good networks and there's good transfer of knowledge, etc. A lot thanks to Jenny and the Irish in Britain. But I've never had any connection, it's never been suggested, there's never been any talks about connecting or communicating with any of the physical centres outside of Ireland, you know, be it Sydney or Boston or New York, etc., etc. And it struck me listening to you that, and also to Mark really, there's a big lack there, and also a big opportunity, I think, as well, for the centres, be it physically or not, to transfer some of the knowledge of what's going on well in their countries. What are they doing at a community level? Or we entertain a lot of business groups up at the London Irish Centre as well. So I'm curious, Niall, have you any thoughts about how that could be evolved? Or
yeah, I think that's the Irish centres in America have begun to. The one in Queens is interesting because it's a very big centre, but it's catering more and more to non-Irish, strangely enough, because literally, the Irish are a lot of undocumented people. Are much more comfortable going to an Irish centre, irrespective of their own background, than they are going to an official government centre for help on issues around immigration. But I think it's an excellent idea. But for instance, we do have this issue of young dislocated immigrants committing suicide. We have a very significant problem, which is also exacerbated by the fact that they're undocumented. And I know that you would have similar problems here, and that's certainly something that should be followed up. But I'll give you an example of what we did. After Hurricane Sandy, we went out to the Irish centres went out and they decided they were going to do 2 days of action in the devastated communities, black communities, Haitian communities, Irish communities, Jewish communities in the Rockaways. And we got 600 people to go down, and mostly tradesmen and construction guys, and they rebuilt homes, and we called it the Meho. It was the most successful thing we'd ever done, where we suddenly realised our message should be, we need to give back as well. we need to help at times. It's not just the Irish taking or the Irish saying, well, that's grand and we need another grant or whatever, but it's part of, you know what, this was a major natural disaster. We as a community need to do something, not just for the Irish, but for everybody in that community. I think that's an interesting idea that communities here could also think about, because it gives you a whole new level of respect and acknowledgement that I think is very important.
Okay, Mary?
Thank you. Mary Hickman. I'm a Professor of Irish Studies at St Mary's University College. I just wanted to pick up on three things. One is the chair prefaced the afternoon with how do we connect Irish communities around the world through media channels. And I suppose I think, you know, like post the Good Friday Agreement, really what we're talking about is the public sphere and how that happens, because I don't think there should be any idea that it needs the media to connect the Irish diaspora. The Irish diaspora, the level of families and individuals, is multi-connected. And, you know, through Twitter, you know, various things, all the ways in which emigrants and their descendants maintain their contacts across the diaspora and back in Ireland. So, and I think, you know, during the, in the 70s, 80s and 90s, that there was indeed the impacts that Marianne talked about, but also many of the people who had very great difficulties because they were Irish in that time in Britain survived because of the Irish diaspora, survived because of the communities. And indeed it's true that the Irish Post in that period under Brendan McClure played a vital role in really supporting positions and political positions which weren't in any way given support anywhere else in the media in Britain or Ireland, come to that. So that was really important. But now those constraints aren't there. My point is that really I think the media channels, it behoves you to represent the complexity and heterogeneity of the Irish diasporas. You know, I take your comments, Helgen, about the profit motive, and it contradicts your responsibility. I thought that was very well put. But it,
poetic.
But I do actually think that it behoves to express the complexity. And, you know, there's loads of differences within the Irish diaspora by regions and places people come from. Both generations of emigrants have differences, generations of Irish descent have differences. There's all sorts of complexities, and that ought to be really represented carefully. And I suppose I feel that is something, you know, a few weeks ago there was an article to illustrate what I mean about the Irish diaspora on Irish Central website. And it reeled off six places in the diaspora which were important for the Irish diaspora. Britain wasn't one of them. So given you've got three times as many Irish citizens, immigrant citizens, living in Britain than there are in America, you may have millions and millions more of Irish descent, but of actual emigrant citizens, there's three times as many in Britain as there are in the States. So, for example, and about five, six times as many as there are in Australia. So I found it utterly indicative of a mindset that's quite common in the States to leave Britain out of discussions of the diaspora. That's why it's so great you're here today. Second thing, just a minor one, which is I agree with, and you know, I was in the States through quite a bit of the campaign on the undocumented Irish there in the 90s. And it's true, it's still a big issue today, but we would hope if we're really supporting those Irish people in the States, we're equally supporting undocumented people in Ireland, undocumented immigrants into Ireland and indeed into Britain in the same resolute way. It, you know, the same issues are raised, and therefore I don't think it should be privileges in our support for Irish undocumented in the States, and we don't transfer those allegiances back to Ireland, and indeed I would say to Britain. And my third point is, I agreed with a lot of what Mark said about the votes for the Irish Abroad, and I declare an interest because I'm chair of the Campaign for Irish Citizens Abroad here in London. I disagree with him that I can't tell you how many political campaigns there's been where someone's prefaced it with no political party will ever do, and then outline votes for the Doyle in your case, and it used to be votes for women, it used to be votes for all sorts of people. So we can't take that as read. The issue of taxation vis-a-vis voting is irrelevant, as has been pointed out millions of times, and I disagree with you. I was there at the Constitutional Convention. That was an issue raised, but it didn't overswamp. And in fact, what you had at the Constitutional Convention was people in Australia, America, Britain, elsewhere, around the world, France, saying, great to have the vote for the presidency, but what we want is the vote in the Doyle. So that is actually the kernel of the campaign. And my final thing on that is that here we're sitting in a building connected with the British Parliament, and I think looking at votes for the Irish abroad in Ireland, which obviously raises issues for Northern Ireland in particular as well, I think it's all part of realising that people have dual allegiances, dual citizenships. This is the way forward. And so we don't just talk about galvanising the votes in the place where people live. It's also about having a representation for a diaspora back in the homeland.
Thanks for that, Mary. I think you're about the fifth speaker to mention Brendan McClure, and I just thought I'd give a name check because his daughter...
Inevitably,
his daughter Sinead is here. Would you like to make yourself known? Sinead? and Sinead was at virtually every meeting that we convened in the House of Commons for to make sure that we could keep the Irish post up. So thanks for that commitment, Sinead. Okay, at the back...
And Andy Rogers, one of my hats, chair of the Irish International Business Network, and I just have three short points I want to make. Firstly, just about the media. I think it's fantastic what has happened over the last few years. I think you've taken us to bat on getting together, but now I think we're well served with very good, I think, media. None of us have an excuse really today not to be able to pick up and understand the different nuances of the different media. Between yourselves, the Irish World, the Irish Times, and all the different websites. So I think that's a really good, positive message. Second is, you mentioned the business side, and you talked about the kind of the older generation, and now where are the younger ones. Well, just today, the young lady just sold her business for £24 million.
Mm.
A few weeks ago, John Griffin sold his Addison D for 300 whatever it is, million. So there are business people out there, perhaps quietly, and probably not as out front as there used to be. There are 48,000 directors in Companies House registered in Canada who are Irish, who name themselves as Irish. Not everybody, by the way, necessarily puts down Irish, as you know, from the census nowadays. So there is a very vibrant, I think, Irish business community out there, and the networks that are working away with them. From Irish Business Society, London Irish Graduates Network, my own one, Irish International Business Network, and so on, are kind of working with them and helping them to grow on.
Sure.
That my last point is that I do think, Mark, that there is a lot more going on, awareness now, because since things got difficult there 6-7 years ago, suddenly an awareness of the diaspora became much more apparent to business people, who have been reaching out to business people over here, a lot more. And there's a whole kind of, I think, number of things, like the President's Distinguished Service Award that has been given. That's the first time the country's ever recognized its diaspora in an official way. The Irish Abroad Unit does, I think, a good job within the constraints that they have. And I would love to see, as time goes by, your aspiration. But it wouldn't be that difficult to expand it somewhat. The funds that are brought in here through what you used to call DION, now the Irish Immigrant Fund, has kept so many organisations going and vibrant here. So there are a lot of these. The work of the semi-state bodies here, Enterprise Ireland, do fantastic work with business people, quietly and perhaps unheard of. And I think all of those things together are combining to keep a very vibrant. I can only speak for kind of the UK side, but it's important that we don't, when we're great at beating ourselves up, I think. I think at times when we don't congratulate ourselves and give ourselves a pat on the back, sometimes when things are going in the right direction. And so I would just encourage us to keep going. We're going in the right direction. Not the changes that are happening are all good changes. They're not bad changes. So that's my comment. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. Andy.
I'd like to congratulate...
Sorry, Ty, could you say who you are? And...
Oh, sorry, Ty Galvin, Chair of Brighton Irish. Excuse me. First of all, I'd like to congratulate Elgin Leon for reviving the Irish Post. And I can go back to 19... I'm an immigrant from Ireland of 52 years. And I can go back to the founding of the Irish Post with Brendan McLuhan, who did a marvellous job, and he was the only voice we had at the time in this country. Coming back to diaspora, there's another point I'm going to get later on. We're talking about international diaspora and worldwide. What we need to look at closely is the diaspora in this country. I'm involved with the GAA and various other organisations in Brighton, and we've recently managed to start up another Gaelic football team from people who are now coming over again. The point I'm making is that none of those people will ever vote in this country, and they're immediately entitled to vote in this country. In the first 6 years, they are never contacted by any political party, and I take issue with the Labour Party over this, since there would possibly be a Labour vote. And none of these people will ever vote in this country, not to mind for an Irish president, you know, while they're living here. And as you said earlier, we should organise better in that respect here. I was in Brighton, I've lived there for many years, having worked all over the world in the shipyards and the electrical industry, the length and breadth of this country and the electrification of the railways. I was in Brighton when the Grand Hotel was unfortunately blown up, and I was invited to talk there with the All Party Conference a couple of years ago, which I spoke about. We ran an Irish club which was possibly 100 yards from the Grand Hotel, and that was subsequently closed down as a result of that bombing. British intelligence didn't know where to start. They immediately got on to the local Irish population. It's a bit different being down there rather than being in a heavily populated place like Liverpool or Manchester or London, where there would be a... So we were targeted pretty badly. And some Irish people in local services on frontline positions actually took elocution lessons to disguise their Irishness, and some were actually asked to do. I couldn't afford it. And if I did, it wouldn't have done any good, because I was only out of Cork 28 years. But the Irish Post, again coming back, was our lone voice in the 70s and brought the Irish back together when the Mail and the Sun actually ran a campaign actually saying about Irish people, look after, if there's a guy next door that's Irish, check him out, he could be a terrorist. So we got through that, and again, I'd just like to thank the Irish Post for their efforts in that respect, and Brendan McLuhan in particular, and congratulations to yourself for taking it over. Thank you.
Thank you, brothers. Thank
you. Thank you. I think we'll have Declan Moran. I think, in fact, you can say who you are, Moran. You can say who you represent.
Declan Moran. I'm from the Irish Embassy, economic counsellor, recently arrived, so I don't have the history that lots of the contributors around the room have spoken of, unfortunately. I'm here weeks rather than years. Nonetheless, I'm getting a sense of what it is to be Irish in London and in the UK, and I was struck by a number of the comments made around the room so far. What Andy Rogers just said about the number of directors of companies in the UK, that's stunning, and I've heard that number numerous times since I came here. And that kind of links then into a point that Elgin was making about the next wave of the major Irish players in the UK. Most of my time here in the last few weeks has been focused on the networks, working with the agencies and so forth. And I'm struck constantly by the point that Marianne made about the positivity and the pride that the young Irish people that I've come across over here have for Ireland and want to do something for Ireland. And it's how to kind of tap into that well of positivity is something that I'm going to spend a lot of my time here over the next few years working on, I've no doubt. But just going back to the point that Elgin made, the Global Irish Economic Forum met recently, and as far as I can gather, out of that are coming a couple of initiatives that are certainly being considered at this stage around how to tap into the diaspora right across the globe. But I'm obviously looking at it just purely in the UK context. A database could be developed, which is kind of hitting on one of the points you were making. I think that's something that's coming out of the forum. And another thing I think is very important is the potential for a young forum. I think the average age of those who are on the Global Irish Network and at the forum is in the, you know, beyond the 40, to put it politely, where I am obviously myself. But to tap into that young diaspora and to see what they can add and give back to Ireland. And it's not, I mean, I know there will be a lot of criticism about these kind of initiatives being kind of just looking to get something back from people that are not out of the country. But I think that's countered, in my view, by the positivity that I get consistently across all of the networks that I've been dealing with in London in the last couple of weeks. Only last night, talking to people out of a network in one company that here, Morgan Stanley, there's a network of over 200 Irish people, talking to some of those people last night. And I mean, one of the comments they made was, it's great to be Irish. It's a big plus. It's a great advantage to be Irish. And I think that kind of echoes back then to what the previous speaker was saying about how it used to be. You know, it wasn't such a great place to be Irish in the past, but it certainly is now. And bring this whole thing to a kind of a positive conclusion, if I can, if there's time, to get some sense from Elgin as to how, what his thoughts are on how to tap into that, identify the new wave and tap into that new wave. I mean, there are these initiatives coming out of the forum, but where do you see that kind of thing evolving from your perspective?
Well, just going to say one more speaker, I believe a businessman from the business community, and then we'll give speakers a chance to respond.
My name is Sean Fitzpatrick. I'm the chairman of the VTC group. And I would like to just refer to my own experiences to highlight what I regard as being the success of being Irish and Irishness in London. I came here in the summer of 64 for the summer holidays, and I'm still here. But I came to a London that was very, very different from anything I'd experienced. The perception of Irish and how Irish saw themselves. We had serious problems with how we were perceived within the communities here in London. So we dealt with that by becoming very insular. We had our recreation, our leisure, around our own areas, whether it be the church, the local Irish club, the local Irish dance hall, the GAA clubs, etc. But we were very, very insular. And I was part of that insular Irish community for many, many years. And then I saw this opening up. I was here right through the Troubles, and it was a very sad time for the Irish in Britain. You know, you would have to go into work on a Sunday, on a Monday morning, and work with English and other races who had just got the news of a serious bombing or something else. And it was very difficult for many of us going through. But I must pay a tribute to the English, the British, that I could never say that they held me back from anything I wanted to do, that I had the ability to do because of my Irish. And I would say that I would pay tribute to the British as a very, very tolerant race because of that. But I saw the whole thing opening up, Ireland, the Irish people gaining confidence. They were supported to a large extent by the Irish Post,
the Irish world, the work done by the embassy, the work done by ministers coming over here. So the whole perception of Irish within our community and the confidence gained from that. We were not just regarded as being the labourers. We were suddenly regarded as being the professionals within our communities. And you referred to it's great to be Irish. That is a relatively new impression that we have of ourselves. Back in the 60s, when I came here, we kept our heads under the parapet. We got on with our lives as quietly as possible. I think that this development has come along because of the hard work of a lot of organisations like the press and like politicians and the embassy, etc. And how can we now get on, develop that on an international scale? I think we've done a good job here in England, in Britain, and how can we actually use the same methods to actually encourage and mould together an Irish diaspora that is confident in who they are, what they are, and what they can actually together contribute to the faltering Irish economy as it is at the moment.
Okay. I mean, thank you much for that. It was quite a strong testament. We're going to open it to our two speakers now, and then perhaps we'll have another three or four questions afterwards.
Can I just pick up on the two points people have made? I think it's... Andy Rogers has spoken there of business people, you know, John Griffin, and I'm not sure of the other lady. I think the person I'm describing or seeking to find are actually more empire builders. I think Sean here is one of those. I think that, you know, there's just a slight difference. When I say beacons or aspirations, it's just business people are, you know, or if you're an aspiring business person, you're getting on, you know, you want to see an empire per se being built, but something that's going to stand the test of time. And I don't see that they're not as prevalent. Maybe I'm not seeing things, but I don't think there are many people of my age building empires at the moment as there were 30 years ago. And they're still strong, their empires at the moment. So that's just one thing. We can get into buying and selling a technology company or that sort of thing. I got to see the tail end of what Sean mentioned there. I can specifically remember, I only came in November 92, but I can specifically remember being in Ireland. I can't remember the exact date, but for March 93 for the Warrington bombs. And there were no Irish in the factory I went into. I was going in on shift work for the 1 o'clock shift. And I will never forget my head, you know, going in. This is a big factory. And, you know, I have to say that there was nothing said. You know, the English were fine. You know, I don't know what, if they were bombing in Ireland, if we'd been so nice. I have to say, I never, you know, odd, small little incidents. Not what I've seen out and about in other places, but they were absolutely, absolutely fine. Great host country. That just the two points. I never really got to be in the UK and the troubles. I saw the very tail end of it there. I did know for one instance of what it was like to go into an English factory after an IRA bomb going off, killing people. And I'd actually flown into, I think, Liverpool Airport that morning. But that's that. But again, I don't, coming back to your point on identifying, and I'm specific here on empire builders, they are different. I do believe research interns would identify them. And I'm talking about people that aren't there to sell their business. They are there to build an empire for 50 years and pass it on in some shape or form. It's a different sort of person. Okay, thanks.
Thanks for that.
Well, it's obvious to me that the end of the Troubles is even more important in Britain than it is in America. And yet I can tell you that in America, it has opened the doors in a profound way on levels that Irish Americans, not all Irish Americans are interested in Ireland. but a lot more are interested in heritage, history, background today than they were during the Troubles. And one of the ways that that's reflected, and talking to Marianne and the professor here, is the schools of Irish studies across the United States have absolutely mushroomed. It's unbelievable now when you look at NYU, Notre Dame, UCLA, all these great Irish centres of studies, which did not exist in the last 15 years. So that's one of the areas I think it's incredibly important, that we not only educate ourselves, but we educate British people who are interested in our heritage, in our history. And that is the great thing I think that we have, this amazing literature, history, all the things that we talk about that are Irish, that can now come to the forefront because the Troubles effectively are no longer impacting the relationship. I think that's a very critical area that you have to look at, is the area of Irish studies. And the other area is as Elgin said, he's absolutely right. I mean, what we do is we have these interns constantly looking for people. And it's amazing who you turn up. It's amazing when you walk into the president of Coca-Cola and he turns to you and he says, nobody's ever asked me about my heritage. And how important it was for him to hear somebody talk about that. So I think that idea of the business community and the network is absolutely in play now where it wouldn't have been even 10 years ago. And I can see, you know, even today's discussion, the very use of the word diaspora was not used 20 years ago by people. And unfortunately, we don't have more Mark Daly's in Ireland, because Mark is a guy who gets it. When I go to Washington, I go in to see Congressman Paul Ryan, he says, have you met Mark? That's how this guy is there before everybody. But Ireland also needs to be educated, not just the lip service, not just the, you know, bring them home and let them spend money here, but the whole vast array of positive things that the diaspora can bring to Ireland. So I think Mark has a big job educating other members of political parties, not just the lip service aspect, but the real aspect of it. And in conclusion, I just say it's been so heartening and so encouraging for me to go back to America and tell people that, you know, the Irish in Britain are very much focused, they're very much in a good place now, and that we can expect very good things in the future. So thank you for having me.
Can I just add a quick word to that? One of the things, Niall, you'll be very pleased to hear this, people like Mary and I have been teaching Irish studies really from the 1970s, and my impression, yes, early on was it was a bit of a dangerous subject. It was usually only first generation Irish or those whose mothers or fathers were Irish who would come and do it. But that actually started to change even before the end of the Troubles, because peace was on the... And I mean, my son, who's 24 now, he started telling me when he was about 16 that it was cool to be Irish. It's cool to be Irish. And I started noticing that in English students who didn't really seem to have much Irish background, who just wanted to know about Ireland. And that has continued. They're getting a different kind of teaching than they would have heard in the past about the Irish always being the victim or the poor or the peasant. You know, they're coming out with a much better understanding of Ireland's place in the world. So thank you for raising that.
Okay, we're going to take a new round of questions now. I think the previous round kind of focused on business. And if we take a few contributions from the community sector. So we're going to have Michael Ford, who I first met, I think, Michael, in 1991-92, when we set up the North Wales Irish Society. We looked to Manchester for guidance, and we went over there, and we had a great crack all together.
So, Michael. Sure did. Yes. Chairman of the Irish World Heritage Centre in Manchester, and the existing or the old one was set up and opened 30 years ago. On January the 1st of this year, we opened phase one of the new one. Now, the new one will include a global diaspora museum. And it's time we told the story of what Irish people have achieved worldwide. And we've been asked the question, well, why isn't that in Ireland? And our answer to that is, well, the diaspora aren't in Ireland. They're all over and making a massive, massive contribution. What we have achieved so far is that we have got a 15-acre site overlooking the city centre. We're less than a mile from the city centre and we've got 15 acres on which we will be building our museum and the conference centre and all the other activities that will take place within that. But there's also planning permission for a 170-bed hotel on site. And we've got planning permission for 11 football pitches, 9 five-a-side and 2 seven-a-side that can be converted to a Gaelic pitch. And from next month, we'll have our own Measurelink station, Stop. That'll be in place. The whole of the area has been named Irish Town. Now, in the 1800s, there was an area of the city of Manchester known as Irish Town. That was at the beginning of the 1800s. Sadly, they all died away with cholera and other diseases, and it became an industrial site. The industrial site then had changed its name, so Irish Town was lost. We've managed to get it back now, and what we're proposing to do with getting it back to show how the Irish of today have progressed from the Irish of the beginning of the 1800s. And with help from the Department of Foreign Affairs and particularly Enterprise Ireland to identify the companies, most of the building is built with Irish materials imported from Ireland. All the stonework came from Ireland, the insulation, the roofing, and then we got two architects in Dublin to design our bar. And what we're trying to do is to have a contemporary, well, we have got a contemporary building with all the modern facilities. In the old building, we had the thatched cottage, but Ireland has moved on from thatched cottages. And we want to show the new modern Ireland and take complete advantage of the internet and all the new connections. The other thing we'll have is a place for Irish businesses to come and meet their clients, new businesses in Britain. And our research has shown us that there's 30 million people within 1.5 hour drive of our new centre. That's 6 times the population of Ireland. And definitely an awful lot of business can be got from there. The companies who have supplied us with the stonework and everything else, timbers, have already got business. One of them has got, they supplied us the masonry stones, flags. They've got an acre of stonework in Northumberland and another massive job in North Wales, all from the people viewing their standard and quality of work. On the outside, we have a ring fort, a massive big Celtic ring fort. All natural Irish stone, 2,500 tons of Donegal stone. Inside that, on the ground, we have the Celtic cross. Now, what we're going to do with the Celtic cross, it's a pathway, is insert names, Irish family names, in alphabetical order, so that you won't have difficulty finding your family name. And we are leaving spaces between the names because we know what's going to happen.
What's my name?
We'll forget it and we'll get a little bit of earache. then within the four areas of the Celtic cross, we'll have images of the four provinces. And against the far wall as we overlook the city, because there's nothing between us and the city, only flat land and trees. We're going to have images of the five continents. And in front of the building, when it's finished, we have a water feature. And to get out to those areas, you have got to cross water. Everybody left Ireland had to cross water. So to get to the five continents or get out to those areas, you'll have to cross water. We have already got some timber work in our bar area, which is very, very contemporary. Bargo that's 5,000 years old, authenticated by the National Museum. And we've got stone from where the White Man was filmed that we'll be using on the water feature that's 9 million years old. So we'll be showing old Ireland and new. Now, between the, we have parking spaces for 200 cars and a helicopter pad. So just in case
for 200 helicopters.
One helicopter.
That's what I'll give.
And on the outside, between the rain fort and the fencing outside, we have already set some fruit trees, and we will be from next March putting in allotments areas, which we've done with a local group of Irish people, and beehives. We've got lots of beehives to go in there as well. So we're still on the way, but we're at least we're getting there. The only thing that we are short of at the moment is a few bob. We had everything raised before the recession. The recession cost us £4 million in land values. So we've now got to make that up from some other way. But people might like the name on a room or whatever. But we have reached out to the rest of, obviously this wouldn't have happened if we hadn't the great support we've got from Manchester City Council. And it's something that we got told off about years ago when we were starting off with the old centre, who were too politically involved. Well, it's paid off big time. And the situation in Manchester at the moment, Chief Constable is from Tuam, his parents from Tuam. The new police commissioner, his parents are from Tipperary. And we have got a massive number of Irish councillors as well. So I would advise every community, wherever they are in the UK, get involved with your local politics, because you have a say. The one thing I'll finish with saying, they might take everything away from us as Irish people worldwide, but the one thing they never take away from is our spirit. We've got the spirit, and we'll overcome anything that's there in front of us. Might be difficult, but spirit wins out. That's something they never take.
Jenny, and then perhaps something for the GA.
Hi, I'm Jenny McShannon, and I'm from Irish in Britain, formerly known as the Federation of Irish Societies. I've just been listening to all the words that were talked today. I've heard about the history, the future, the passion, politics, the troubles, the peace process, business and community, success and vulnerability. And it just struck me just how diverse our experiences are and how much that will continue. And I was also just on the theme of mother, reminded of being at a conference in London Irish Centre 2 weeks ago, and my six-year-old putting on his Ireland shirt as he got dressed in. Mommy, where do I come from? And I thought that was a question for you to ponder for the next 36 years and 56 years, because being part of the diaspora is so many different things to so many different people, and I think that's something that's really important in terms of the discussion at hand today. And I wanted to talk just very quickly about two things. One was the Irish diaspora connecting home and domestic issues, and one about the Irish diaspora connecting globally on diaspora issues. I think becoming an Irish migrant, we have very much like my son, new experience of what it means to be Irish, and that's very different. And our engagement in Irish domestic issues is not really just about viewing from afar. I'm sure I don't speak for myself that we have families at home, and elderly parents at home, and maybe homes at home, and possibly for many people in the future at home. So I think that we cannot but have an investment in the economic recovery, and I think that's so important in terms of businesses and the media and the community engagement at home. And as businesses and individuals, we very much support from afar, but I suppose, again, drawing on Mark Daly's comments, I think there is a role potentially in exercising our civic responsibility to Ireland's wellbeing and to actually free vote and enfranchisement. Just to very quickly touch on the Irish diaspora connecting and a touch on what we're doing as an organisation. We've, as I say, recently changed our name from Federation of Irish Societies to Irish in Britain. And that's really because we want to demonstrate our increased breadth of engagement across the community, to be better able to reach out to all those different things, whether it's the past and the future, to hold the past and hold the heritage, but also look to the future and these new migrants who are both young people and not so young people who are also coming over, people who migrated, went home, brought their businesses and their families home, and they're now migrating back. And I think that's really important that we're able to reach out to them. And something about everyone being, for us as an organisation, everyone being able to be part of Irish and Britain, depending on what that means to them in their own individual way. From our perspective, it's very important to engage in new technology and skills to respond to changing experiences of migrants. And for those who find it easier to connect and reconnect online as well as in print. And I was thinking about, when you were talking about whether it's an Irish community or whether it's Irish communities of interest, and these people talking about the business, myself and Sean and Michael will know about some of the services for the Irish most vulnerable within the community. There are the Irish creative markets, there's the print. So it's just that there's so many Irish communities of interest within our Irish community, and that makes it so rich. And that for us is a reason for changing our name. And just to finish, I just want to say that the Irish media on that is our way to engage globally, and we really want a media that brings us together and those different communities of interest to connect us, enable us to work together on what are shared interests, a passion for Ireland, a passion for our own future, both the personal, the business and the global. And as Andy says, we've got the Irish Post, we have the Irish World, we have the Irish Times, and increasingly we have the Irish groups on LinkedIn and the business networks. And I just think there's something about some collaborative approach across that network that feels so important, not just for the success of business, and there are business people here, but for businesses to support community, for that corporate social responsibility, for that well-being of a community and of a diaspora group here and globally. Because, you know, if whether you're giving or generating or receiving, it's all part of the well-being of a community, and I feel that's why this is an important discussion. I'd like to see it go further, not just in how much we've moved from the troubles, but I think the thing that struck out for me was it's not like the troubles are there and now they're gone. It's like we carry some of that with us, but we have to be looking forward, we have to be working in a different way. So really just keen to see how that can go forward.
Pay tribute to the work that Jenny does personally and professionally for the Irish in Britain, I think her role is funded by the embassy. I want to pay tribute to the embassy for that and the Dion money and the follow-on from the Dion money, £12 million a year. I know it's been cut back because of austerity, but that money has helped Jenny, who has helped us as an All Party group, and has helped communities across the UK. So it really is good sterling work that they've done. Keeping on the issue of the of community, does the GAA want to?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry.
My name is Lloyd Colfer. I'm here today to represent the GAA in Britain. I suppose the Irish Post is very important to us because it covers a lot of coverage across Britain. So all our Gaels and everybody coming over from home. Also, the Irish Post generously sponsors our All Party competition, the underage competition that we run for all the kids, young English born kids of Irish heritage that are playing our games over here. So that's vitally important for us. So I suppose, personally, my own story, I represent the new generation of people coming over in the last couple of years. I arrived 2 years ago, and I was met in the airport by a member of a GAA club here, the King and Kerry Gaels, and they provided me with a bed, a job, and a ready-made family unit and friends and people to look after me. And I suppose that was vitally important to me, and my story is repeated hundreds of times across the country. The role that the GAA plays in stopping that dislocating factor that was spoken about earlier is vital. I guess also, this year I was a member of the London Senior Footballers who reached the Connacht Championship final for the first time ever. And the way that the Irish community here in London and Britain and all over the world brought in behind us, and the message of support and congratulations that we received, really showed what the Irish diaspora can achieve, and the way that we can all move positively forward. And I guess the GAA is a vital unit, we see a vital unit, and played a really crucial part in that for all the Irish abroad, and that, you know, it's vital for the Irish diaspora. It's quintessentially Irish to be a member of the GA club, to play the games that you grew up playing, and it's going forward something that we see that hopefully you will continue to do and continue to help us.
It's very
thanks very much for that. We're going to take take Sharon one more speaker, and then we'll open it up to Elgin and Niall.
Hello, my name is Sharon O'Regan, currently working on projects for the Tricycle Theatre. Where do I come from, Jenny, your six-year-old asked. I used to ask that question all the time too. My parents came over here in the late 1950s. They met on the boat, and I always asked that question. And then an elderly service user in the organisation that I used to work for, Brent Irish Advisory Service, said to me, well, if your parents had decided to go to China, you wouldn't call yourself Chinese, would you? So I'd say definitely Irish. And it's just nice to really hear that there's a lot of positive speakers out there, because it's all about positivity, really, I feel. And my belief is that when I change, the world changes. How is my attitude? The work that I've been currently doing with the Irish travelling community has been very successful. We've worked on various projects, and the one thing in common that I've had with the Irish travellers, I believe, is faith, because I feel that in every aspect, the basis of success is faith, really. And after 28 years in the fashion industry, it took the Irish travelling community to actually show me my purpose. And I'm very grateful to them, and I hope to continue the work that I do with them. Like Sean Fitzpatrick also said, he is quite grateful for England too. My mother always embraced England. She didn't have such a good time in Ireland, actually, having been brought up in a Good Shepherd convent over there. But England has been good to her. So I'd also like to thank the Irish Embassy for all the support that they've given me, and I've got the opportunity to also thank the Irish Post, and especially to Fiona Audley for all the support that she's shown with the work that I do. So thank you. Thank you.
It was community-based. We heard from the Tricycle Theatre, the travelling community, the GAA in sports, Manchester Irish Centre, and Jenny and the Irish in Britain, so a nice set of speakers there. Any reflections, any comments?
On behalf of the Irish Post, you know, we do feel we are, I'm sure the Irish world feel the same, that we're intrinsic to the community. I do feel we have both Siobhan and Fiona do sterling work in getting out into the community and getting those news stories, and supported by the rest of the Irish Post staff there. We're fully committed to continuing doing that. You know, I don't mean to blow our own trumpet, but, you know, Niall will see the paper we produce is, you know, it's top class on a weekly basis, and we'll continue to do that for the benefit of the community too. To pick up on the young gentleman from the GAA again, vital part of the community, and it's great to hear his story there. We've two full-time sports journalists and up to, I believe, 10 contributors at any time. You know, absolutely committed to that. It's one of the things that is probably certainly helping our circulation. We're trying to do more on the online front there. And just on another side and commitment, I made it down to McHale Park on the 21st of July to watch you. So, well done. Thank you.
Okay, Mark.
Thank you. It's been a great afternoon for me. First of all, I think the fact of an Irish dinner at the Dorchester, where the Irish were probably dormant at best 30 years ago, is a great example of where Elgin's thinking is. And I think it's where the community thinking should be. You should think big. I find that there's often an overwhelming kind of need to feel that people in Ireland control what Irish is. It doesn't matter if you're Irish from Wales, Irish from Scotland, Irish from New York, Irish from Alaska, Irish from Melbourne, Australia. You have your own identity, as you so beautifully put, And that is so critical. It's just as valid an identity. When you send millions of people out of a country over centuries, a new form of identity grows up, and it's Irish in Britain, or Irish in America, or Irish in... So nobody has this holy grail that says only us can have it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's very, very important that we recognise that. And the Irish in Britain have been amazing. I mean, I'm going to tell you a story that I only found out last 2 days. My nephew works for a media organisation here, and everybody was wearing the poppy. And he's an Irish guy, and he said he had, you know, kind of, should I wear the poppy, should I not? And then he went and he researched the history of my mother's brother, who died on the last day of the war, Second World War, fighting for the British against the Germans. A guy born in County Clare who came out here and gave his life for this country. That's the Irish in Britain too. There's so much. And he said he wears the poppy now because he has somebody that he connects with in terms of his identity. That's the Irish in Britain as well. So it's a great diverse community. And I feel so strongly about the Irish Post, both from the McLuhan connection, but also from getting to know Elgin, that this is such a critical part of the infrastructure. And I think you're making exactly the right statements, listening to the different communities. The GAA, I was that guy. I landed in Chicago in 1978. I got a bed and a job, and what else could I need from a GAA team? I had no relatives. So I think it's fantastic that this community is coming together so quickly, and I hope to write a great story about it and keep writing these great stories. Thank you.
Thanks. Right, that's great. Well, I'm about to finish. We're going to let Stephen Lloyd have the final word.
Yeah. Well, but before you, Chris, yeah. Thank you, Chris, for bringing it together this evening. Just one real thought. I'm half English, I say, half Irish. One of the fascinating things about this country is English people are bloody sight nice in their media. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
That's the thing. The English people, on average, are so much nicer than sections of their media, and I believe that factually to be true, and from some of the stories that have come out today, it really is true. Now, I don't quite understand that common drum of certain sections of English media, but we'll move over that. Just one thing from a colleague from the embassy. We've had a number of meetings with UN ambassador, which is really, you know, tremendous. And he's moving into big shoes. Bobby was a very active ambassador. The change in the Irish that I've met in the last 10 years is completely different to my mother's generation. Completely different. It is confident. It's the Celtic Tiger. We're business people. They're proud to be Irish. Great to be Irish. That sort of phrase. And that is a wave of change that I think all of us in our different way really need to seize. But that's not to take away the fact of the astonishing history within this country the Irish has had. My grandfather was from Mayo, obviously Catholic. He was joined the British Army in the Somme. And then the British Army, or the British group, that particular thing, separate from the astonishing tolerance and niceness of the English, some people then took a decision to bring his regiment back for Easter uprising. That's the paradox with this country. So there's some wicked things done, but I never forget, and I really mean this as someone who's as proud of English as I am to be Irish, is the intolerance of the average Brit is absolutely fascinating, but their sections, their media, God, I hate them. That's as a liberal. Okay, thank you.
Thanks for that, Steve. Right, I think we'll draw things together now because we've been sitting here for 2.25 hours. And I want to thank our guests, Elgin and Niall, who have responded so positively and intelligently on many of the issues that have been raised on sport, culture, community, business, immigration, emigration. So thanks for that, lads. And I want to thank all of those who have contributed to the debate and all of those who have attended today. Hopefully this is the first in many meetings that we'll have looking at the diaspora issues over the coming years. And just to say that this venue here, House of Commons, Portcullis House, is your venue. You pay your taxes, and part of our job is to open these fine facilities, not just for the rich and powerful, the businessmen and politicians, but for the wider community, and that you are welcome here. And as I say, hopefully this is the first of many debates and discussions and actions that we'll have as a result of this meeting. I'm going to ask Martin if Martin's been keeping some notes there. What are the actions of this? Listen, can I just say he is an action man. he does sterling
might
work.
Not look it, yeah, but
he does sterling work on many, many fronts.
That's very kind of you. I think I have a sort of shared experience with everyone else here that you think, well, this might be something. It might, you know, might kind of come off. I think it was a wonderful discussion that we've had and listening to reflect. Jenny said the diversity of it, but it was just the breadth. We all know that the social media is here to stay. We all know that the Irish around the world have changed so much in the years. We know the troubles. Hopefully is into a new phase. We all have the sense of responsibility of making that diaspora work, of doing something positive and useful with it. We all know that the relationship between Britain and Ireland and the wider diaspora is important. And within our own professions, I was just sort of like, you go around and the number of different ways in which people were expressing a similar view about the need for more networking or the need to make the links to draw things together. You know, I think in one of Chris's letters, he talked about this as being a bit of a work in progress. The work that's been done by Jenny and her colleagues in the in Irish in Britain of holding the diaspora voice consultation to say, here we are, here's the Constitutional Convention in Ireland, and we would like a say in it. We had a say in it on same-sex marriage, a say in it in extending the votes to the Irish in Britain, and so on. It's about playing a role and how we do that. I hope we can go from this. You know, you come out of a good conference and you say, God, if only you could bottle that discussion. Well, today we have the discussion bottled. And hopefully next time we do an event like this, we'll have a camera at either end of the room so that half the people aren't speaking from the back of their heads. Very grateful to our friend who's been patiently filming us today and the Bow Tie Group, which is part of the facilitators of the House of Commons who facilitated that. We will be editing the discussion, putting it together, and putting it out on YouTube so that people who haven't been able to be here can do that. And also people in Ireland and around the world may wish to be able to do that, and it will be easy to do it. We'd like also to see the newspapers reporting on it. Maybe we can circulate some of the speeches. But it's a work in progress. I think there's easily the capacity here to do a very big, much bigger event of the same character of discussions between different fields with workshops and some arts elements of it as well. We can think about that, and it's one of those things that we should discuss. But also doing the same kinds of discussions as we have been having in this room today, to have those in other centres of the Irish diaspora, and just begin a way of working which I think can take us all forward. But fair play to Chris, chairman of the All Party Parliamentary Group on Irish in Britain. The activities are relentless, and the MPs will tell you that. We go from the Flann O'Brien readings for Irish Writers Week that we had 3 weeks ago, and Chris and Mrs. Doyle, Pauline McLean, where we united for the first time. We have this meeting today. Next week we have a meeting with Anne Cadwallader, who has a new book dealing with some of the most difficult aspects of the troubles of the collusion of security forces and so on in a particular area of Mid-Ulster. So it's all those issues that the politicians are coming together around, and politicians from across the parties. So it's a good formula, and I think very successful. But thank you all for participating today, and thank you very much to our speakers, who I thought more than fulfilled what was it they were described as, these extraordinary entrepreneurs. Well, here you are. I think this is an extraordinary event, and we're extremely grateful to Chris Rowan for all his energy, dynamism, and enthusiasm for pulling this all together. Thank you very much, Chris.